you all for joining us for ALD's newest series open to our members, ALD Career Conversations. Last year, National Alpha Lambda Delta changed our tagline to help taking you from first year to career. So this program looks to do just that, to explore the path from where you are now as a student to where you want to be in your career. And we're truly grateful to our successful alumni like Andrew, who have agreed to spend some time to share their journeys. And we're thrilled to have so many ALD members with us to join the conversation. So during the conversation, please remember to keep your microphones and videos off during the main discussion. And then we will have an opportunity at the end for you to turn on your cameras and interact a bit and get your questions answered. So we'd like to start by introducing our facilitators and our featured guest. Facilitating tonight will be myself and ALD's Executive Director, Eileen Merberg. So Eileen, can you please introduce yourself?
Hi everyone, my name is Eileen Merberg. I'm the Executive Director of Alpha Lambda Delta. We're headquartered in Rochester, New York, in upstate New York, and I'm so thrilled to see you all here. Thanks for coming.
And I'm Trish Maxwell. I'm the Director of Communication for Alpha Lambda Delta. I work in the national office with Eileen, supporting our members and our chapters. And now I'd like to introduce tonight's guest speaker. So Andrew Weisberg was inducted into ALD in 2012 at George Mason University. He had a dual major in government and international politics and history. He earned his JD in law from New York Law School. He currently resides in New York City and is an assistant corporation counsel torts division in the New York City Law Department. So we want to get started with a few fun questions just to kind of break the ice. So Andrew, if you could only eat one meal for the rest of your life, what would it be?
Well, French fries are my favorite food item. I don't think most people would consider it a meal, even though I probably would. So I'm going to go with spaghetti and meatballs.
Okay. If you want an all expenses paid 7-day vacation, and let's pretend that all COVID restrictions have magically disappeared, where would you go?
Oh, that's easy. London. I just love the mix of history, culture, art. So as soon as I can, hopefully I'll be going there.
Good.
Nice. And what did you want to be when you were younger?
The earliest I can remember, I wanted to be president of the United States. I just thought it sounded so much fun to be the representative for our country, travel all around the globe. And maybe one day, who knows?
Okay, so I'll get started with a little bit more serious questions, but not too serious. You were mentioning this a little before we started. Talk a little bit about your role with ALD when you were an undergrad. What was your undergrad experience in Alpha Lambda Delta?
I was the president of my Alpha Lambda Delta chapter at George Mason University when I was a sophomore. And then when I was a junior and a senior, I was a senior student advisor. So I really enjoyed the experience to lead our executive team. I got to work very closely with our advisors, Dr. Donna Fox and Dr. Tana Kamara. And I got to meet all different types of people across the campus. So it's an experience I really look back on fondly.
Good. And just a sort of quick follow-up. Do you remember getting invited to join? Did you get an email or a letter? Or how did you, do you remember getting invited? Receiving the invitation.
I do remember receiving the invitation. I believe it was by email.
Okay. So what I'm wondering what inspired you to join to begin with? Like, was it the recognition? Was it involvement, aspirations for something more? What do you recall what you thought when you first were invited?
Well, when I was first invited, it just felt so special. That was the first honor society I had been invited to in my college career. But then when I went to our induction ceremony, I started learning more about the work of my individual chapter. That's when I decided I wanted to become more involved.
Okay, great. Great, thanks.
So you said you were a dual major. How did your major and your different academic experiences help prepare you for your career in law?
Definitely the research and writing skills, particularly in history, but in a large part also my government major, being able to go to different primary sources, evaluate the credibility of each source, and then bring together an argument in a written product. That's what I do every day as an attorney, and that's the background that's really helped me.
Say again what your major was.
I was a dual major in government, international politics, and history.
Okay, great. Okay, as Trish described ALD's tagline from first year to career, can you talk a little bit about your path from first year? So our students who are joining us today, they could be any class level, but they're all undergraduate students, we're assuming. They might be sophomores, juniors, and seniors. So what was sort of the path like when you first started to graduating to your career, and sort of speak to the students here about were there internships they should be pursuing and what kinds of research or graduate school research, anything, any advice you have about that and what your path was?
Well, when I was at George Mason, I was fortunate to have the time in my schedule to take a number of legal classes as an undergraduate, and I actually declared a legal studies minor. So through taking those classes, I got to meet several practitioners in the field, learn about different careers in the law, and I came to realize that's the profession I wanted to pursue. So I went right from college to law school. That's not the most common path now, but it's a decision I'm still happy I made. And then throughout law school, it was just an experience of, again, meeting more practitioners, learning about which legal career was the best for me, and eventually landing where I currently am.
If a school doesn't have a minor in legal studies, are there other things that students could be doing extracurricularly, or I don't think a lot of schools have, am I right or wrong? I don't know. A lot of schools I don't know that really have minors in legal studies. So what might they do if their school didn't have that?
No, you're correct. Many schools don't have a legal studies minor. Really, the best way to learn about law is to do an internship. I know that many legal organizations, including the New York City Law Department, take interns who are in college who are seeking to learn about law school. And then there are many college graduates who take a gap year or two. They work as paralegals in a law office to learn more about the role of lawyers and if that's a career they want to pursue long term.
Good, good. Okay, thanks.
So, Andrew, we know you attended law school, the New York Law School. Can you talk a little bit about like what your courses were like, what you did to prepare for law school?
Well, in virtually every law school, the first year and even part of the second year is the same. All law students take a number of required courses that are eventually tested on the bar exam, which a student needs to pass to become a practicing attorney. The way I prepared for law school was I actually read a number of books about it, because law school is very different than the undergraduate experience, how the courses are taught, how the tests are given. Eventually, it's something you learn during law school. It's just something most students pick up on, but it's trial and error. Students will learn what works best for them, and then they'll adapt their own style to do well in law school.
So when you were in law school, is that when you decided that you want to work kind of more in the torts division, or was that something that happened after you were in the field?
Well, I knew before going into law school that I wanted to be a litigator. I wanted to be the type of attorney who's not always behind a desk, where I'm able to go into the courtroom to advocate for a client. Throughout law school, I was able to look at different types of litigation careers. The summer between my first and second year of law schools, I worked in housing law, representing clients who were about to be evicted. That was a very worthwhile experience. I'm very proud to have had the opportunity to help those people stay in their homes. But then later I learned more about different government organizations that were looking for lawyers. And I started working for the New York City Law Department between my second and third year of law schools. And I just enjoyed representing a government entity, the different resources you have as a government lawyer, and the extensive training you get working for the government. And that's why I've continued to stay.
Nice. So talk a little bit about what does a typical day look like for you?
Well, I'll start by talking about the pre-COVID days of lawyering, which hopefully those return at some point. I used to go at least one full day every week to court, where in the mornings I would be doing oral arguments before a judge, and in the afternoon I would be doing discovery conferences. Then the other days during the week, I would be doing depositions, writing motions to get cases dismissed for the city. I'd be reviewing discovery, which is different types of evidence that's produced during a court proceeding. I would speak with witnesses. I would negotiate settlements on cases. Now, of course, we're not going to court in person, so there are no in-person trials yet, but we've created a very robust virtual system. So just this morning, I had a virtual deposition. We do virtual oral arguments, and we're preparing to eventually do trials again. So things are starting to get back to some semblance of normalcy.
That's so interesting. And I know you're in New York City and in New Jersey, and they were the kind of first hit by COVID. How long did it take the New York City Law Department to kind of transition to an online presence? I mean, I'm sure you had to scramble pretty quickly.
It was difficult at first because our job was the exact type of job you could not do virtually. We always had to be in person. There was really no way to do it over the computer. We did have a system from working from home before this, so we were able to adapt to that. But the New York courts were closed for about a month to a month and a half when the pandemic first started. The state courts, federal courts work a little differently. So during that time, we weren't able to file motions. Many of the cases, there was very limited activity. But since then, we've come back. We're moving the cases as much as we ever have, and we're able to keep moving things forward. So we're very happy about that.
Great, thank you.
Great. What is one thing you wish you had done as an undergraduate student to better position yourself in the career, in a law career? Is there anything, as you look back, what you wish you had done?
Well, first, I wish I had participated in a legal internship during college. If you can believe it, I didn't have any experience working with a legal entity prior to going to law school, which I'm fortunate that worked out. I love my career now. But I very much encourage students to have some working experience in the law, because no matter what you see on television, no matter what you might learn in the classroom, doing it in law school, doing it in practice is very different. And I also wish I had considered taking that gap year or two between undergraduate and law school. For me, it was the right decision going right to law school, but law school can be a very draining experience. For many students, it can be difficult moving right into that environment. So it's a good idea not only to learn more about the legal field, but to give yourself a little break, get yourself ready for law school.
Sure, right. Do you have a favorite thing about your career? You do seem to love it, and that's great. I love to see that. Is there anything sort of that rises to the top as your favorite?
My favorite thing is to advocate for a client. We've always been in a position where we're trying to get something and we say, we just want someone to fight for us, someone to argue on our behalf. And that's what I get to do. Right now it's for the city of New York, and I get to be the city's voice in the courtroom, and being able to defend the city is just a fantastic job.
Awesome.
Oh, Andrew, did you have, as an undergrad, did you have any formal or informal mentors?
I did. So both of my ALD advisors, Dr. Fox and Dr. Kamara, were great resources. I still speak to them to this day. Mm. And through college, as I mentioned, I was able to take a number of law courses. So I was able to meet a number of practicing attorneys, many of whom I still speak to, who still give me advice, and they've been great friends over the years.
So if I, let's say I wanted to pursue a career in law and I wanted to get a law mentor, but didn't know where to start, what would you recommend for a student to kind of find a mentor?
The best way to find a mentor is to put yourself in a situation where you're meeting other lawyers. That could be by taking a class offered by an attorney, that could be participating in a legal internship. it could be as simple as just going to a bar association meeting, which I assure everyone, even though a bar association is for lawyers, if you're a college student, you say, I want to learn more about the legal field, they'll be more than happy to invite you to their events. And just speaking with other lawyers, lawyers love giving advice, and everyone who I've met has been really willing to speak with me whenever I need to.
Awesome. So again, you were very involved in Alpha Lambda Delta. Kind of looking back, how, in your opinion, can ALD members use Alpha Lambda Delta to get ahead in a career in law?
Well, by getting involved in Alpha Lambda Delta, I really gained essential leadership skills. By being on the executive board of my chapter, I was able to lead the initiatives we were doing, both in events on campus and throughout philanthropic endeavors. I was able to meet all different types of people across the campus. And as an attorney, it's given me the drive to keep moving forward, to trying new things, and also to speak with all different types of people. I was mentioning to you before we started that I had a deposition this morning. I depose all different types of regular everyday people. By working with Alpha Lambda Delta, I met people from all different backgrounds, and that helped teach me the skills I need to speak with everyday regular people today.
That's excellent, thank you.
So I think you've answered this already in a couple of times, actually, but let me ask it more explicitly and let you give any other advice, which is what advice what did you have for students, maybe just in general. I'm going to assume that the students here are interested in pursuing a career in law, going to law school, taking the LSAT. We're going to open it up for questions in a minute. But what would you say would be your top pieces of advice for students?
Well, in addition to what I mentioned before, where you definitely want to have some practical experience at a legal internship or as a paralegal before going to law school, I would really recommend thinking about why you want to go into law. There are many people who want to go into the legal field because they think it's exciting to call yourself a lawyer, or they're going to make a lot of money. And those aren't good reasons to become an attorney. There are very few legal jobs that pay those big dollars you may have heard about. And after working for quite a while in the legal field, you want to have something you're working towards. For me, at the law department, we say our mission is to advocate for the common good. That's what keeps me going as an attorney. And you should really find something like that. Find if that's why you want to be an attorney.
Great, great advice. One other quick question, and maybe someone was going to ask this, but I'm curious. Just how does one pay for law school? What are the options? Are there scholarships out there? Is there aid that most schools offer? Do we got to take out $200,000 in loans? How does one pay for law school?
Well, there are people who take out extensive amounts of debt, particularly at the best law schools where it may be more difficult to get a merit scholarship. But there are many law schools who do offer merit scholarships. So I advise students, look at what GPA range a law school's admitted students come from, what LSAT range those admitted students come from. If you have a GPA and an LSAT that's better than the average student, you have a good shot at receiving some type of merit aid. Also, for students who are looking to go into public service, there is public service loan forgiveness where you can work for a public service entity for 10 years and whatever loan is outstanding, I believe, is forgiven. Although I do want to warn people, that's not set in stone, so there's no promise that that's going to continue indefinitely.
Right. Okay, good. Okay, so let's open it up. If anyone has a question for Andrew, this is your chance. You can please feel free to turn your cameras on and your mics on, but you could also type a question in chat if you'd like, and we can see it there. But we'd love to hear if there's any questions or things you're curious about. Anybody have anything?
I have a question. So yeah. You mentioned that you read books on law school, so you knew what to expect. What type of books did you read? Like, do you remember any of them?
Well, if you go to Barnes and Nobles or Amazon, you could always look up law school prep books. I forget the exact titles of the books I read, but there are several titles out there that go over how law students should think, how to approach law school exams. And if you read those books, you'll find when you go to law school, it really matches the methods that the teachers show you for how to take a law school exam. So I definitely recommend looking. There are a number of books like that, and at least it gives you a good taste of what law school will be like.
So you're not talking about the like an LSAT prep book. This is something else.
No, there are actually books for how to prepare for a law school exam, how to prepare yourself for law school.
Okay. Thank you. Great.
We have a question in the chat from Nicole asking, what's been your most rewarding experience?
My most rewarding experience came during a legal internship I had in law school. I was working at the New York Legal Assistance Group for the Holocaust Reparations Assistance Program, and also for the Evelyn Frank Program, which helps elderly people who are trying to receive Medicaid benefits or keep their Medicaid benefits. And I had a case there where a Holocaust survivor was being sued by the German government. They were claiming that his late wife had received fraudulent reparations, and they were going to sue him for over 20,000 euros. As you can imagine, a Holocaust survivor being threatened with a lawsuit by Germany, that's very upsetting. Mm-hmm. So in that case, I did quite a bit of research into German law, and I was able to write this letter explaining to the German government why they shouldn't commence a lawsuit against our client, why it wouldn't be fair to do so. And we were glad they finally stopped hounding him. And it just brought him a sense of peace, especially he was a 90-year-old man. He just wanted to enjoy his life, and we were happy we could provide that for him.
Okay, another question here from Kaylee. What was the most difficult thing you experienced on your journey to becoming a lawyer?
Those are good questions.
That's a good question.
The most difficult thing is probably the self-doubt. And some of you may have heard of this. There's something called imposter syndrome, which is very common among law school students and lawyers in general, where sometimes you'll feel that you're not doing the best job, you're not good enough. And just because of the way law school is structured, for those of you who don't know, you're graded on a curve. You're graded not based on how much knowledge you have, you're graded in relation to how your classmates do on exams. So it can be a very competitive environment, and it can just be very stressful. So the advice I have, you just need to take a step back and you need to just assure yourself you're doing a good job, you can do this. And if you work hard, take the feedback you're given, you are going to be the best attorney you can be.
Can I, great, that's great. Can I ask the next one, Trish?
Yeah, sure.
So the next one's related to the LSAT, and I just have to share a little personal story here. So my daughter is graduated from college. She's taken a couple of years off. She's 23. So she wants to go to law school. And so the question is, what advice do you have to prepare for the LSAT? So she has these books, and each one weighs, I swear to God, 15 pounds. They are so big, and she's got like five of them, and it's weighing down our house. It seems a little overwhelming. Like, how many of those LSAT prep books do you need? And are they all different? Like, it seems like so many, and she's taken the test, you know, the samples in the back. So anyway, I'm curious about that, but what advice in general do you have to prepare for the LSAT?
So I'll start off by sharing a little secret with everyone. I was fortunate. I did well in law school. I passed the bar exam. I never had the type of migraines that I experienced while taking the LSAT. After 2 hours of taking an LSAT, I would get the worst migraines. I took a 2-day bar exam. I never experienced anything close to that. So I first want to assure everyone, no matter how you do on the LSAT, no matter what anyone tells you, that is not indicative of how you will do in law school, is not indicative of what type of attorney you will be. people prepare for the LSAT in different ways. Some people just self-study through books and by taking practice exams. Some people take courses. I took a course. My advice is take a mock exam at first, see how you do. The best score on the LSAT, I believe, is a 180. And just then try out different methods. Try self-study. If you can't afford a course, try taking a course. See what works best for you. And there are some people who have to take the LSAT multiple times. I ended up taking it twice. So don't be afraid if you have to take it more than once.
If you were a part of a panel with you talking, with someone like you talking, what would you ask, Andrew? Is there anything that didn't get asked?
I guess the question that I would ask, which I don't know if I was asking a panel, if I would have felt this was an appropriate question, what's the state of the legal field today, particularly with the economy? So I'm sure many of you have read with the financial crisis, with the COVID-related shutdowns, the legal field, it's challenging to get a job these days. And it's been challenging before during the 2008-2009 economic crisis. So really, that's not to say that the legal industry won't come back, but that's another reminder just to think carefully if this is the right field for you and be prepared that it could be a difficult journey to get the type of career in the law that you're looking for.
That's a really great point, because I have been hearing I guess it ebbs and flows, but are there more lawyers than there are jobs? But it, who knows, in the next 4 to 5 years, it could really shift. So good. We do have another question. So what if you're not sure, you really have a strong interest, but maybe you also want to go to medical school? And so you can't decide, you might be confused, and you're just personally trying to decide between a couple different fields. Any advice for how to make that decision?
Well, first I would recommend seeing if you have a particular proclivity for one skill set over another. I didn't take many science courses in college, and I really wasn't considering medical school, but there are different skill sets, as you can imagine. Law school is quite different than the type of thinking and the type of learning you'll do in medical school. So you want to see what your mindset is best suited for. And then again, you want to try getting internships in the medical field, in the legal field. You want to see if you enjoy one type of thing over another. If you're really still unsure, there are some doctors who become lawyers, some lawyers who become doctors. It's a lot of education. It could be a lot of debt, but it is possible. And I see someone else said you could pursue both. And that's true. There are doctors who decide to practice. There are some lawyers who decide to become doctors, and then they testify about medical injuries. So it is possible to do both. In my personal practice, I deal with many plaintiffs who have personal injuries. So I review medical records on a daily basis. So even though I never studied in medical school, I do have some medical knowledge because of that.
That's great. That's a great question. A great way to look at it. Okay. So let me thank all the students for participating, for being here, for being a great audience. Thank you, Peyton, for the clap. But mostly, thank you, Andrew, for your time, for your involvement with Alpha Lambda Delta and your support of ALD over the years, your leadership when you were on campus. But thank you so much for your time and expertise during this session of career conversations today.
Absolutely. Thank you for having me. Thank you, everyone, for tuning in. And Trish and Eileen, you have my contact information. Please feel free to share with anyone here. If anyone has any more questions, needs any advice, I'm happy to speak to anyone.
Oh, that's great. Thanks. We will do that. You might get some emails.
Great. Thanks so much, Andrew.
Great. Thanks, everybody.
Bye, everyone. Bye, everyone.